Well, you probably already know Angela Braniff from This Gathered Nest, and we get to visit with her today to talk about her new book that's coming out, but also she has been doing some mega decluttering, and so it's really fun to hear how that has changed her house, but also some other things that she learned through the process. Well, hi, I'm Dawn from The Minimal Mom. So excited to be joined by Angela Braniff today. And so we're gonna talk about her book, some big decluttering she's been doing at her house. But Angela, first, I wanted to ask you, what has it been like being in isolation right now with a large family?
You know, we're very used to spending a lot of time together anyways, just because we work from home and we homeschool. So we're used to kind of being together all the time, but even still, the sort of just knowing that you cannot get away, you cannot go, you cannot do things, you can't, we don't live in quarantine despite that lifestyle. Right. It might seem like it, but it's still unusual for us to not be able to go and do things, you know, apart from each other. And so that has been, you know, it's refining on the relationships. Yeah. That's kind of how I try to look at it. Like, you know, I don't know, I spend so much time with my husband already and, you know, we have a good time, but it's also like, like I need 5 minutes, like 5 minutes without speaking to the same 9 people over and over and over. Yeah.
I think that's how it's been for us. I think I feel like we've had some of our best moments lately, like as a family, and we have had some of our lowest. Like we have been like
exactly
so high and low these last few weeks. And so I keep
waiting
for it to kind of level out.
Yeah, it's so true. Cause I've had moments where I'm like, here, like, this is so beautiful. I just love this family time together. And like, we're taking walks and we're doing things and you see like the preciousness in it. And there's definitely been a lot of those moments that I've been not so eager to return to normal life. But there's also been moments that I'm like, listen, I am going to need to meet a friend for a margarita or something. I just need a minute.
Yeah. Well, I have to imagine, most people know who you are, but do you want to tell us just a little bit about your family and then we'll jump into talking about your new book that's coming out?
Yeah. So my name is Angela Braniff. I am a mom of 16 kids. I'm just kidding. I only have 8. See, I like to start with the high number because when I bring you down to 8, it's like, oh, that's not so many if you start with 16. But I do in fact have 8 children through birth and adoption, and I make content here on YouTube. We have a family channel that's just sort of vlog type content called This Gathered Nest. And then I have a personal channel just by my own name, Angela Braniff. And I like to just share like anything and everything I want there. And my husband and I just launched a podcast together actually. So that's been way more fun than I thought it would be. So
that's awesome.
That's kind of, you know, our everyday.
And so tell us about your book launches officially tomorrow. So Tuesday, April 28th, of course, we'll link all the details below. I've gotten to listen to the first 3 chapters. And I don't, if anyone's a book listening type, I have loved that you are the one telling it because I've been listening while I'm out walking and I just feel like I'm on a walk with a friend and it has been so fun. And I was so bummed when I got to the end of the third chapter. So tell us, tell us first about the book and then how it came about.
Yeah. So the book, conveniently I have one right here in front of me. The book is called Love Without Borders. And it's really, technically it's a memoir. It's my story of, you know, sort of what started out as this life believing that I had to check all the boxes and, you know, sort of live within this like checklist life, if you will. You know, you get married, you have kids, you buy a house, you do all these things, and then you're happy, right? And I did all of those things and I still felt like something was missing. And so for me, it's really my journey of learning that life outside the boundaries of, you know, the checklists and the shoulds and, you know, this is how you should do it, that life outside of that can be really, really beautiful. And recognizing how all of our highest moments and lowest moments really conspire together to write this beautiful story for our lives. And it wouldn't be the beautiful story that it is without each of those things.
Yeah.
So it's really, you know, and obviously for me specifically, that looked like secondary infertility and adoptions and special needs adoptions. And we did an embryo adoption. And, you know, a lot of those are the main threads of my life, but, I like to, and I hope that people will be able to, you know, not see necessarily my story as, you know, like that's the purpose of this, but for them to really pluck out and pick out the beautiful and unique things in their own stories through seeing how I've been able to do that over the years.
Yeah. And so, you know, what I've thought a lot about is for people that have been wondering, how do I know if God is calling me to something like this, like way outside of my comfort zone? How did you know in each of these situations that, nope, this is actually what God is asking me to do right now?
There's actually a whole chapter in the book where I talk about this concept of the Kol de Mamadakah, and it's a story in the Bible, and loosely translated, that is a Hebrew phrase that means the sound of thin silence. And it's something that I really learned to kind of hone in and listen to this voice of God in my life by quieting my life, by quieting my mind and setting things aside to hear him. And for me, I kind of describe it in the book as a feeling of belonging. And even though you're not sure why, you can't explain it, you don't know, you could never really articulate why, you know that this is a door that God's opening for you, you just do. And for me, it's that feeling of belonging, even in times that were scary and uncertain, just knowing, like, I know God has me here. I don't know why, I don't know what's gonna happen, I don't know what's on the other side of the door, yeah. But it's just this intense, like, belonging feeling for me that has helped me to be able to more clearly recognize God leading me.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I know Tom and I are like just starting the foster care journey, and so we've just kind of started telling people, and so we get the comment, that is so cool that you can do that, but we could never do that. And I'm sure you've gotten this comment before.
Yeah.
So what do you say to people when they say that?
To me, it's kind of twofold, because there is absolutely a group of people for whom adoption, foster care is not an option. There are legitimate reasons that you cannot show up in that way.
Yeah.
So I don't want to ever make those people feel like I am condemning them in any way or anything. But for the majority of us, that's not true. And I think that it's really important to recognize, in what ways are we preserving our own perceived ideas of safety and comfort,
yeah,
at the expense of the most vulnerable people in the world. And I say this is, you know, all the time, and every time I get the opportunity, I shout it from the rooftops, because to me, vulnerable children are truly the most vulnerable, because they can do nothing to change their own circumstance. They can't do anything to pick themselves up by the bootstraps. They can't do anything to advocate or protest or hold marches. They can't do anything for themselves. They solely rely on adults around them to advocate for them and to show up for them. And to me, as a believer, it's very clear in the Bible God's heart for children. And to me, it's a mandate that's there without question. So how we show up and how we do that is going to look different for everybody. But I've never been a foster parent, and I have so much respect for foster parents. It's something I would love to do, but we happen to live in a state that we have too many children. Apparently that's 8 is too many. You know, but it makes me sad, because I think that in many states, a lot of times it's the larger families that are willing.
Yeah.
So I hope to see reform in that area in my lifetime, but I would love to be a foster parent. And I think every foster parent I've ever known has always said, it's not about me.
Yeah.
It's about the kids. And I think we, you know, again, we tend to make things about us. And it's hard. It's hard not to, right? We're human,
yeah,
we're selfish,
right,
we're sinful. It's really hard not to. But I think that for me, the biggest sort of narrative shifter in my own mind has been to say, what if that was me? Or what if that was one of my children?
Yeah.
You know, when I had my two biological daughters, that was a moment of clarity for me to recognize that, what if something had happened to me and I didn't have family to take care of my kids? What if my two daughters just got picked up in a police car and are now waiting for a foster home to open up because they have nowhere else to go? And not because I didn't love them or didn't take care of them. I think we can sometimes separate ourselves from these tragedies in ways that we disconnect, as if we're not the same as those people who that kind of stuff happens to.
Yeah.
But the realities are vastly different than that. And I just think that when we can turn it around, we can hold up the mirror and say, what if it was me? What if it was my kids? You would want someone to run through fire for your child. And so I think that we can do better.
Yeah. And you have actually been doing some massive decluttering at your house, which I can link to some of those videos down below, which was so fun to see. How does your house feel different? Because I feel like maybe one of the first steps for us even being able to contemplate foster care was simplifying our house, that it just things feel more possible now. So how does your house feel different now that you've simplified more?
You know, it was something that with adding that eighth child, I don't know if there's like some kind of scale that happens, but when we added our eighth child, it was like the scale tipped this way. And all of a sudden, things that I'd been able to manage before suddenly felt overwhelming. And it was really difficult. And I felt like my whole home just fell into disarray. So I really went on this like few month mission of decluttering my entire house. And since then, I tell you what, it's literally made us all feel lighter. My children included, my husband included, we are better stewards of what we have. I feel like we take better care of our belongings and we're more intentional about what we bring in. So it's just this like overarching feeling of like, that feels better. Like, I feel like I can think more clearly.
Right.
I don't pay attention to my office, because this is a whole nother story. I haven't even done this room yet, but inside my house is very well organized and decluttered, and I love it. And I almost feel like, how did I get through this many years of my life not living like this? I don't really know how I did that.
I'm impressed that you made it to number eight. For me, it was number four, was just like, oh my, like we can't, like we just can't. That's awesome. Well, this is so fun. What would be the best way for people to get a hold of your book?
It's available so many places, Amazon, Target, Barnes & Noble. You can support indie bookstores and local bookstores by buying the book through bookshop.org. You can do curbside pickup at Barnes & Noble, Audible, all the different things. It's available in a lot of places. Most places you would look for a book.
Awesome. Well, be sure to check it out. You'll be able to get it right away pretty much now. So that's awesome. Well, thank you so much for joining us. And of course, your family is just so fun to follow along with on YouTube. I love your personal channel too. It's always fun.
I feel the same. Yeah. Thank you so much for having me. It was so fun.
Awesome. I never know how to like end it then, right? It's like, okay, see you later.
Bye.
Bye. Yeah.